Well, I think I started the Six on the Street project just because I had a real deep interest in live music sessions and had been watching them from La Blogo Tech. And yeah, I just really loved the impromptu nature of the filming, and you felt like you were there while you were watching the musician play as they're playing to camera. And I think I just really wanted to start something like that for Adelaide musicians and see what would become of it, see if anybody would be interested.
So after Sam sort of presented me with the idea that was Six on the Street, I was very interested. I really wanted to get some more experience and get into my own sort of projects. And that type of thing really related to me, the way that we could work with musicians and that I could get a start in an industry that is very, very tough to get involved in.
I got involved with Six on the Street after being approached by Sam, who is our producer. We were studying media management together at uni, and our common passion for music came pretty obvious when we would chat about it in our class discussions. And so we were always bouncing ideas off of each other about various music things, even, you know, trying to adopt it into our assignments and that kind of thing.
Six on the Street film involves, I guess, taking an Adelaide artist and putting them in a certain location of Adelaide and shooting an interview with them, having a chat about what they do, as well as shooting kind of generally a live acoustic performance with them. And yeah, it's just done in a setting that is impromptu, as all live music sessions generally are.
There's a lot of people in Adelaide who, you know, are just as passionate as us about sharing what Six on the Street was about. It was just, you know, these artists were there, they just needed to be shared with people in a format that people could readily find.
It really makes you be on the ball about what's coming out and what's available and what you should be plugging to everyone else and trying to get them to see.
Everybody's really working hard to do their best to put Adelaide on the map on a national platform, because sometimes we do get overlooked as a bit of a backwater, but you know, there's a lot of people who are trying to change that view, and I guess the fact that people are trying to change that view really just says it all, that view of Adelaide as, you know, a desolate art space is, you know, it's misconceived. Obviously, Adelaide gets a lot of festivals that are travelling through the city, like every other city. They get the big day outs, they get, you know, the sound waves and all of those things. But there's a few Adelaide festivals that are uniquely Adelaide. Adelaide Festival, you know, Fringe Festival is another franchise, but Adelaide's got a really fantastic Fringe Festival, and it's probably the best Fringe Festival in the world. WOM Adelaide Festival is probably the greatest thing that ever happened to musicians in Adelaide, because in today's, I guess, indie environment, everybody injecting trace amounts of cultural or generational differences into their music just to give them that edge. Whereas, you know, pop bands or folk bands will create music that's traditional and that's fine, but people really want to listen to music that has an edge. What WOMAD offers is just, so many cultures from around the world bring their best musicians to Adelaide, and Adelaide's musicians then absorb everything that they've seen. Suddenly their boundaries are shifted. They're not the same as what they were before they attended that festival. They think, why am I using these instruments? Why are we using them in this way? It shifts the paradigm with musicians in the city. And you can see that with artists like the Shaolin Afronauts. They're kids from Adelaide who, for some reason, playing Afrobeat music, which is complete other culture from what they've experienced. But it's the music that they enjoy, and it's the music that they've seen, it's the music that they want to play.
The festivals that are in Adelaide are actually some of the most important parts of the cultural fabric of this city. And certainly some of the biggest influences on, well, I mean, I can speak personally and say it's been a big influence on me, but also I know like a lot of different artists across a lot of different genres. Obviously the Fringe is, you know, fantastic because particularly for the buzz that it creates in the city when it's on. But for me, the two biggest ones are definitely the Adelaide Festival and WOM Adelaide, because they're the only kind of vehicles in this city that really bring out a diverse range of big acts, like Adelaide Festival bringing out like Ornette Coleman and Pat Metheny and artists that really get people in the jazz community excited and in other kind of musical fraternities excited. They're really the only avenues where artists from Adelaide, but particularly young artists who maybe haven't travelled a lot, can see what the world has to offer, see what people are doing in the world that's different to what's going on here, and have a chance to experience it live and then assimilate or react against or whatever. But all of those things that happen naturally, if you live in New York and you can go and see the greatest artists in the world every night, then that's a great advantage to you as an artist. So we need those festivals here, and they're incredibly important to Adelaide artists' growth. They have a kind of an element of that in their lives, I guess, once or twice a year.
Thank you.
I guess when people think about the Adelaide music scene during, you know, that busy time of February, March, you can see that it's thriving and the streets are full with people just walking around and enjoying comedy, music, theatre, all those kinds of things. But when those festivals pack up and go in every other month pretty well, you probably could write off the music scene as being a bit quiet and maybe there's not enough for people to do. But I guess if you do a bit more research and read your street press, listen to radio, everything, and just talk to the right people, you can find that there is a lot of creative stuff going on and there's a whole bunch of events and people that are making sure that we've got some great events to attend during the year and really have to be on the ball about where you go, otherwise you could find yourself being really bored at a venue with hardly any people watching a band, or you could go to a venue that's packed with people. You just have to know where to look, I think.
Forwards is an arts movement. It's art and music and culture in Adelaide all rolled in together. And it started as a blog.
The blog's a way of promoting local things, anything that's coming to Adelaide, anything like that. So whether it be an international artist coming to Adelaide or a small artist from around the corner you think needs a bit of hype. And from that, you know, we use our nights as a way of promoting local stuff that we've showcased on the blog.
Because we've done such a nice cross-section of artists, I think them bringing their entourage respectively and crossing that over has sort of got the venue in a nice place and got people to know about what's going on.
It's always been like a good atmosphere. Most people who come always, you know, feel like there's something for them, there's something there. And
people bringing, like bands bringing their friends, and everybody seems to like know everybody there. And
it's like a big family.
I think, well, I feel comfortable there, and I hope other people feel comfortable there as well. You'll see people there, you're like, oh, they're here to see the band and you know them through someone else. And it just seems that way in Adelaide, but everybody in the arts and music, everybody knows everybody, or everybody together under one roof makes it a good atmosphere, and people get around that and they just keep coming back, or if they don't, whatever.
I think, yeah, there's a whole bunch of events that happen really that are allowing our music scene to be pretty active. I think about Alice Fraser, who's booking Lamar Sundays out at Glenelg Surf Life Saving Club, bringing a whole bunch of great artists from Adelaide as well as interstate, and in some cases I think possibly international. That's just making sure that the venue's packed. When I think about other venues or people, probably Ben Clennett, or Ben David as they otherwise know him, has also put on events called Get Folked, which gives kind of a platform to emerging artists to play their music, particularly of a folk genre. Just these kinds of people are putting on great events, I think.
Always the one to be early. myself almost every night, and I hated sex for most part of my life. But when you came along, you showed me them songs. It changed the way that I think. Cause I never used to curse, I never used to drink. Now I cuss all the time, and I'm covered in ink. And I know I wouldn't trade it for the world.
I think having tried to organise a few events with friends around Adelaide, we found that there are a few venues that do cater for small Adelaide bands, I guess, but there's probably not too many venues really, just because a lot of them being cold due to noise restrictions and that kind of thing. But there are a lot of people that are probably active in making a lot more venues active, I guess, that previously were just like abandoned buildings and that kind of thing, and it's really helping a lot of Adelaide musicians to present their music to audiences.
There used to be a lot more venues around the Adelaide music scene that catered for an Adelaide artist. They were appropriate sizes for the bands that allowed them to get an atmosphere that really extended the performance more than what it would be in a, you know, in a larger venue. Lets the crowd get close, and it really pushes them to be up close and personal with the band. And it means that the stage presence of the band can really get people excited, get people into the music. So that means a huge band like God Dammit Dammit fitting on such a tiny stage somewhere like the Jade Monkey, it creates a hectic atmosphere that you can't really get at an inappropriate venue, and it's just a call for more small and appropriate venues in Adelaide to be reinstated for Adelaide musicians.
There needs to be more venues that are focused on the arts, especially for young artists. We've got a lot of artists that come through and they say like it's really hard to find somewhere to put their artwork or get an exhibition space that's not going to cost them a lot, especially if it's not full-time, they're not full-time artists. So it'd be good to have more art space for young artists to put their stuff up and get it seen and support themselves for their artwork and what they're doing. I think there is a rise of venues wanting to address the lack of arts or the lack of venues that are willing to support the arts. I think there's a big push for that sort of stuff, and a lot more people are going out there and wanting to get involved. And developments like Renew Adelaide and Format and things that are happening in Adelaide now have just skyrocketed in the last few years, and it's really starting to make it a bit edgier for the art scene here, I reckon.
So we started Format basically by getting borrowed spaces. So we borrowed a studio space just off of Rundle Street that was later used as Tuxedo Cat, and we started out just doing like zine fairs and little shows and little events, and that just kept snowballing and more people wanted to take part. And then somehow I kind of more or less quitting my job and spending a lot of time writing grants, and managed through various dubious means to get the current Format space. In doing that, there'd been this recognition there was just so many people that wanted this kind of infrastructure, and there were so many barriers to preventing that infrastructure, and they were things that, yeah, were just weird regulations or just the sort of sense within government that anything community driven is kind of frightening, which has changed quite a bit, particularly under the current Lord Mayor. And so I started off with Good Format, started Renew Adelaide to try and figure out where all the barriers that were that prevented people from running their own spaces and running their own community and try and remove them. I think the best thing about it is that through having set up a few venues now, I can kind of see this scene building out of those things. Like there are people who come to Format that I don't know, and I watch the same people I don't know keep coming to shows and keep using the reading room and things like that. And it's just a matter of, I guess, finding not only more buildings, but also training up the next generation of people who are going to run those spaces, because there is a kind of fairly high knowledge learning curve to doing that. And I think that's probably maybe the next thing I'd like to see in the music scene is more people who want to run the infrastructure. So not just be in the bands, but they want to run the venues. They want to go and get their liquor licensing, responsible person certificates, and they want to figure out how insurance works, and they want to keep going. And I guess that's the other thing I'd like to see come out of Format is more people, and in New Adelaide is more people, yeah, having those skills.
Legless Octopus, the land version.
in Adelaide, there's not necessarily a market for artists to produce, you know, large amounts of tangible CDs or records or products. Because of that, it can be hard for them to actually front the bill and say, you know, I want 100 or 200 CDs made up of this album that I've just made. And to fill that void, Stobie Sounds, for blues and roots artists, as a community record label, they're stepping in and saying, we'll create this amazing album cover for you, and we'll put this like hand-printed CD into this wonderful thing that people really enjoy having. And they'll do it at little to no cost to the artist, just to help out. And they're just some guys making these like fantastic products just in the shed at the back of their house, just to support. And that really kind of summarizes the best part of the Adelaide music scene, I find, that people are just trying their best to help each other out. And Stobie Sounds are just the best example of that.
What we do is sort of exactly what the bootleggers were doing in, say, California and New York in the late 60s, early 70s. They were out record companying the record companies by not only giving people great music, but hand printing these beautiful album covers and producing them in such small quantities that almost made people want them, because, you know, as soon as they were released, they were gone. Bands like the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, and all that type of thing, the record companies were just trying to clamp down on these bootleggers, but they were in their little workshops in their backyards, like we are here tonight, just pumping out small quantities of these bootleg vinyl. And that, the bootleg business model is sort of what Stobie Sounds is built upon. Yeah. So it's that sort of community sort of fuck you type business model. The only thing that keeps us chugging along is that the music has to be good. You know, those traditional forms of music, those genres that have been sort of handed from generation to generation to generation, and they've found their way into Adelaide somehow via records and CDs and radio. And then there's these young fellas up in the Adelaide Hills who've somehow soaked it all up and got together. And the interesting thing about the Beat of Gypsies, I don't know if this is true, but none of them really listen to Gypsy Swing. They all have their own thing. But Gypsy Swing was the glue that they found worked best with them. You know, they love their blues and their country and their rock and their pop and everything. But this Gypsy Swing country, folk, blues, reggae hodgepodge that they somehow produce is amazingly vibrant and just gets people dancing and makes people move. And that's why we love them. We said yes to releasing their album long before we even heard the album. We said yes because we just love what they do live on stage. And I think it was only about a week or so before the album came out that we actually heard it. And we'd already sort of started printing it up and just slipped the CDs into the sleeves and put it out there.
We'll be right back.
when people talk about the music that they have, that they own, whether it's been bought or not, they refer to it as their music collection. It's a collection, it is important to them like any other hobby, I guess. It showcases a little bit of yourself and gives you something to chat about to other people and share with other people. And I think you're always going to need that tangible element to make your collection. I don't think you can just say, well, I've downloaded all these albums and these discographies and this is the music that I like, because that's crap. A lot of people will download discographies and they'll know like the hits from the band, but they still won't delve any further because they're bombarded with all this stuff. Or maybe they will download an album and they'll love it so much that they'll then, you know, they'll feel a loyalty maybe toward the band and then they'll want to be able to pick up a product and showcase that. Like, you can't just say, you know, I've got this on my computer. You're going to want the CD or the record or those sort of things that are becoming even more, you know, collectible items, limited edition kind of things that you can say, hey, I'm a fan, check it out. Like, actual fan. I buy their music. I think they're always going to have that. I think that places like Clarity Records, which is a tangible store that's selling tangible products, is also going to be important because of even just the community element that they have there. Bands can come in and put their CDs in there. Bands can come in and chat about the scene and find out what other bands are doing.
It is really important for Adelaide to have a physical place for people to walk into and buy local music. Reason being is a lot of artists these days do tend to still release CDs or vinyl compared to, say, digital releases and that. And like a local independent shop is probably the only place you can get them from, whereas you can't walk into a JB Hi-Fi or a bigger chain shop and buy any, or a local artist can't go in and drop their CDs off for sale. They've got to have other avenues to get them in to the stores, which is pretty difficult these days. I think it's really important for a place like this to be stocking people's or bands' vinyl. You know, there's bands like the Honey Pies or MCATs or a local label called No Patience. Local bands like Steering by Stars, who've done a vinyl and a digital download all in the one package and making many different formats available for people so they can get their music out in more forms than one. There's a poster that kind of circles around that I always think is quite cool, like someone sitting there holding a laptop and someone sitting there holding a record player and people and the caption saying no one ever remembers their first download. People remember their first CD or their first record that they buy.
Shows me once, couldn't find a better thing.
The Beards are a bit of an anomaly on the Adelaide music scene because they don't necessarily play a whole lot in Adelaide, and they're not necessarily an Adelaide band. This isn't where the majority of their fans are. What they've done that somehow nobody else has managed to do in Adelaide is fully utilise online media to peddle their music and to share it with as many bearded people as possible, which seems to be their gimmick. You know, they release CDs and things like that, but what they're really known for as a comedy band are their videos. They have documentaries, they have music videos. When they made the Six in the Street, we had a whole new audience of people viewing our videos just because they bring so much with them. They have such an amazing audience worldwide. That's a really good example of how artists can utilize what's not necessarily traditional. They can make videos, they can make documentaries, they can create alter egos for themselves if they want. It's just another way of becoming successful in the music industry. And sure, there's no textbook for this kind of thing, but they're really innovative. They've made like an iPhone app that anybody in the world can take a photo of their face and then suddenly have a beard on it. And it's like, this is all people that may have been or may not have been aware of their music, but by the end of it, they know who the Beards are, and that's what they want, because they can use that support to sustain themselves. That's what they want. They want to reach as many people as they can. And they're doing that better than anybody else.
I think people without beards are really quite backward. They're kind of like cassette tapes, you know, they're dated. They're in the past. And if you don't have a beard, you're a relic from the past.
That's right.
Either you have a beard and you come with us into the future, or you can stay behind in a little world where you abuse people for having a beard, or they give them a job, or try and make your partner shave. It's
see,
up to you.
See, we're more HD DVD.
Blu-ray.
The next big form.
I like to think we're the one that comes after that.
An MP5 on my chin.
Yeah.
No beard, no good. There's not enough beards in my neighborhood, and you can tell me you can't. I know that you could. You've got no beard and you're no good. No. Well, there's a beardless man in the flat next door. I've never spoken to him before, and I never will until he grows a beard. There's a beardless man in the flat below. I ignore him when he says hello, and I always will until he grows a beard. Until he grows a beard. No beard, no good. There's not enough beards in my neighborhood, and you can tell me you can't. I know that you could. You've got no beard in your no good. There's a beardless boy playing in the street. I pass him and I spit at his feet. It's his own fault.
That's right.
He should have had a beard. There's a beardless girl. I broke her heart. I also keyed her car. It's her own fault. She should have had a beard. She should have had a beard. No beard. no good. There's not enough kids in my neighborhood, and you can tell me you can't. I know that you could, you got no fear, and you're no good, no good. Well, there's a fearless banker, he calls me on the phone. He asked me to pay back my loan. Oh, but I won't. Not until he grows a beard. There's a beardless man, he calls me son. He asked me to dinner, but I never come. And I won't, not until he grows a beard.
Until he grows a beard.
No beard, no good. Not enough beards in my neighborhood, and you can tell me you can't. I know that you could, you got no beard, and therefore no good, no,
no good, no good, no good. Wow, take it away, Johan. Woo!
The potential of the internet for sharing music is it's really limitless, and I guess it's just people's imaginations that are the only thing holding it back. And when people have a bit of imagination of how to use the internet to share music, like Sound Pond in Adelaide, I guess that shows you the potential there, because Sound Pond, anyone can tune in anywhere in the world to artists from Adelaide, and They can interact with them, they can see them live on a webcam, and it's just a completely new experience, and it's innovative.
Yeah, we never really knew what SoundPond was. That was the beauty of it. It kind of evolved. When it started off, it was just Monday nights in my garage, it was just a party, and that was it. Just people playing music they didn't normally get to play, people hanging out and listening and stuff they didn't normally get to listen to. So that's pretty much stayed with it the whole thing. We try not to keep it too serious. Like, now we're all about exploring new music and that's our focus, but at the core, it's just been about having fun, basically. Anything that gets you moving, anything that does it for you, we want to hear it and we want to share it.
It's hard to describe what it is, because it's... You could say, oh, it's internet radio, but it's a bit more than that. It's interactive. You've got video, you've got a chat room, you've got a whole community around it, so you could just say, oh, it's internet radio, but I think that'd be simplifying a bit. It's a bit more than that. It's just SoundPond, that's what it is.
I've always thought the website's kind of the icing on the cake. Like, it's a community behind it, everyone sharing sounds and new music. That's the amazing bit. And like, webcams have been around for a long time. Like, it's just the way we use it is what makes it unique. We've had quite a few people come through already that have gone from almost nothing. They get to meet everybody, and now they're too busy to continue with their shows because they're producing, they're playing two or three places a weekend, they're studying music production, and they attribute a lot of that success directly to us. I don't feel comfortable taking too much credit for it, because again, it's the community, it's not so much SoundPond, it's just we put them in touch and then they talk, they do all the hard work, but I think it enables people, I guess you could say.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. It's not just the people you broadcast to, it's just meeting the other DJs. And yeah, a lot of people that are just starting out have found SoundPond very useful in just meeting a lot of like-minded people.
You know, how can we showcase the best that Adelaide's got to offer and offer people like Dialect and Despair a chance to come and have a show? Guys that are pretty busy, they might not be able to commit to, you know, a show forever, but maybe just for a month. The more we thought about this idea, the more we thought it was great, because you'd get some fresh blood through, you can feature a lot of talent. And a lot of the more accomplished guys in the industry, you know, they've got lives, they can't be here every week for like 6 months. So the first people we thought of was these guys, because in terms of online media, that they've got these really good video clips, they've got a really good sound, they're buzzing right now, and hip-hop is something that we have not featured enough on the station. It's been very electronic, which has been a key focus, but we're all about new stuff, so it's perfect. And we said, hey, can you guys come in? And they said, no worries, and it's working out pretty well.
City of the churches, I throw burners, home of the herb and perverse street murders, closing the curtains on those who observe us, couldn't serve us, that's a wish that you flirt with, it ain't perfect, lot of nerds in their circles, try to spit a verse till they heard my emergence, get service, dialect has returned with despair to burn down the clowns and they circus, and that's certain, my views stay urgent, our crew link deep in the line like cursive, the furthest from a turncoat, we earn notes and burn smoke outside the first hope. A lot of jokes call me Captain Serious. I'd rather be that than go and rap with them idiots. Capture your syllabus, fracture your images, press up wax and give them back the experience. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you're a wizard, capital D, the prolific. Rhyme so exquisite, content explicit. A hot killer, deny bigots and illegitimate cliques who be illin' as if they make business, fakes witness. They whole image ain't shitting. A lyricist, say serious or prolific. A quote sticker, ready to choke the syllabus. Pronouns are broke down, know the militant ain't limited. Diligent, digging in dust, hearing what I ain't feeling for more than enough. Born in the clutch and busting a hip-hop shot clock. Pick up the glock, then I lick off top spot position. Haven't got what you were given, but it's a given. When I rock, the crowd listens. Underground kingdom, built on survival. Skilled in the rhyme, prepared for the revival. Who is it? Capital D, the prolific, the gifted. Capital D, the flow vicious, the illest. Capital D, there's no gimmicks. Who is it? Who is it? D, the prolific. I don't rhyme about festivals and testicles. A kid with the max, intellectual, exceptional. Seed on my set, we still get your girl moving like you said you will. Best with skill. Blessing is set and built. Other heads still attempt to pretend they're real. Render deals, arresting the game's offenders. Apprehending acts who cracked up benches. Tracks ain't a test run. A serious ass is slipping west side. Wet pun to your head done. Get guns, gonna get tongues. Fully equipped to rip your whole clique into sections. Full clip, son. Fools think one bullshit. Hit you, make you miss the red rum. The success, son. Run the risk and then come to admit they counterfeit and dare wrong. Who is it? Capital D, the prolific, the gifted. Capital D, the flow wishes, the illest. Capital D, there's no gimmicks. Who is it? Who is it? Check it. I am intermingling. I'm into singling. Rappers and killing and be yelling as if they really building, but they be chilling. Only thing they ever thinking is if a drinker be spilling gall with them. Revealing the vision and what I written for algorithms. Long driven, razor precision. I'm instilling my hit list for the villains. George Clinton, I talk ism. I'm out of a fact. Your rappers is whacking, dealing with that. Feeling my stats, the contract is up. I'm going out sippers. On tracks, I own back spitter. Wrong cap to diss. I still rip sets. In depth, intellecting, arresting, inject. Intense, suppress the infinite quota. Throw dope, but the most hope to know. Over your head, below ground. Sounds might blow up, huh? Above the clouds, your clowns, I better grow up. Who is it? Capital D, the prolific, the gifted. Capital D, the flow vicious, the illest. Capital D, there's no gimmicks. Who is it? Who is it? D, the prolific.
With all the bands and creative individuals that we've met, it's probably safe to say that we've met a lot of them online through blogs, websites, YouTube channel, everything. And I can remember being sent Spine's Triple J Unearth page and just hearing the music and seeing they were doing well on their Unearth chart. And basically, yeah, just being really interested in music. So I went and attended a gig and just, yeah, really enjoyed it. And we just decided to shoot a Six on the Street film with them and share that with our audience. And then time went on and they just got a bigger audience to come support them. And I think what the online networks are allowing us to do is just build a more active music community to support the musicians that are playing here in Adelaide, as well as the people that are putting on events. And I think it's just a great thing.
Often your friends will refuse to come to gigs because they haven't heard of the band, they don't know if they'll like it, they're busy and they hope to get to another show, that kind of thing. But if you're able to show them what they sound like, then someone's more likely to go see that band. So it kind of gives them that encouragement. And if you link someone to a MySpace page or something that has their really shitty recording on there, they record it on their phone in their lounge room at last band practice and it sounds like shit, is probably likely. That doesn't make you want to listen to the band at all. But if you've got this really quality video that not only is the sound amazing, but there's that visual appeal as well, and you get to have a little bit of insight by listening to what they've got to say, that makes me way more inclined to want to go see a band, or anyone.
The internet's impact on what we used to call subculture has been incredibly positive. Like, it used to be so hard to bring people together and maintain them. Like, you had to rely on sporadic street press, community radio, flyering every week. It's just got so much easier. Like, music scenes have grown because you don't have to know the right people to get involved with them. You just have to know somebody, and it starts congealing and it starts getting bigger and bigger, and then you can kind of like form your own venues out of that. And I think what we'll see from the internet is, like, instead of having one fairly clicky music scene, you can have a whole pile of them. You have like dozens of little scenes, which I guess has been the other good thing. Like, you look at the Four Words people and stuff like that, there are these little scenes popping up and kind of intermeshing.
Music blogs appeal to generally people that are really excited about music, and they'll be actively seeking it out, and they've collected like a list of blogs that they'll regard as like a good authority on what they might like. Australian blogs won't expose you to a massive audience. They will begin to chip away, and they'll get the early adopters of your band or your music scene on side. And if you get those kind of people there, it will gradually spread, and they might reblog it to their blog, because more often than not, people that read music blogs might have their own music blog or Tumblr or whatever, and things get reblogged and regurgitated, and on Facebook you'll share that link and it will go back and forth and people will see it pop up and they'll look at it. And so the internet is a kind of good way of word of mouth and building up early support of bands.
needs to be alone. The only lonely child wants to find one of his own, so they'll be together on their own, together just alone. So they'll be together in their own, together just alone.
I remember reading an article on Rip It Up where Salvadors were the only Adelaide act to be next cropped by Triple J out of 20 Australian acts. And there was a fairly big uproar, I remember, from the Adelaide audience about this being the case. And there was an interview with a certain Triple J presenter, and I remember that presenter saying that obviously, you know, it was a fairly fierce competition between all acts around Australia, but also that Adelaide is perceived to be an isolated kind of city. But I think maybe the reason that more acts weren't kind of next crop is possibly due to the music that Adelaide musicians are choosing to play rather than the music that maybe Triple J wants to hear.
I would say that overall on the scheme of things, Adelaide, South Australian artists are fairly underrepresented on Triple J playlists. We have like a few kind of bands like the Salvadors or Collarbones, but overall it's very difficult for I'd say Adelaide bands to really make an impact on Triple J playlists. I mean, the best you could really hope for as like a moderately successful Adelaide band would be maybe like a couple of spins on Home and Hosed. Maybe you'll get a nice comment on your Triple J Unearthed profile. But other than that, in terms of breaking into like high rotation playlist stuff that would actually get you like onto a larger scale, a larger level of national prominence, probably pretty tough. I mean, we had a few bands in January or February when we had the Fuse Festival come through, an unnamed Triple J presenter coming through, and some people that also will remain unnamed spoke to him, you know, at this Fuse Festival, and pretty quickly became apparent that unless it was a very kind of radio-friendly product that an Adelaide band had that really easily fits in already to the parameters that Triple J have set of what they want in their playlist, then they're just not going to get played, they're not interested.
You hear about a few Adelaide bands moving interstate to Melbourne or Sydney to pursue their music more seriously, and you begin to wonder whether the isolation of this city is really a perceived barrier for whether you make it in the music industry or not. And it was interesting, I was attending an exhibition where the Lord Mayor made a speech, and he said that we're never going to be a massive city, and frankly he doesn't want us to be a massive city. But what I think we can be active in is just making sure that we're known for a creative arts industry here in Adelaide and somewhere where people do want to attend music and see creative art and all kinds of things.
I think the problem with isolation is when people start to see there's always an issue of we should be like the metropoles, we should be like London, we should be like New York, we should be like, in Adelaide's case, Melbourne, rather than thinking like, wherever we are, we should try and be the best possible artists we can be. We should try and produce the most interesting scenes. When you look at really experimental, interesting scenes, like some of the early LA hardcore, they were just like out in the suburbs. There was no scene there, and they were playing shows where they'd have 100 people at the most, so 50 to 100, like the Whiskey where the Germs used to play. That was like 50 to 100 people. That whole scene was a couple of thousand people. Like, small scenes can be really, really productive. It's not about the size. It's not about being in New York or London. It's about having a group of people who learn how to work well together and have this sense of don't accept the limitations, try and have these greater visions, try and pursue your art seriously, wherever you are, and just keep going at it.
Well, so you are
I think the isolation of Adelaide can be broken down by taking bands out on the road and touring and just sending the message to other audiences that we're really serious about how we pursue our arts here in Adelaide, and just telling them that they should come to Adelaide and perform and basically provide that connection between us and the East Coast, West Coast, North, South and Tasmania, and basically making sure that people don't write off Adelaide as being, you know, boring and not having an active music scene.
I think it's really important we do look at ways of having a national music scene, not just local music scenes. I think if we want our music scene to be reach its full potential, it is that sense of like go out and tour, go and see shows in Melbourne and Brisbane. Like Brisbane's doing really well at the moment. There's some really good things going on in Brisbane. But again, that's going to come down to, I guess, a kind of people continue to have that sort of punk rock, just go out and do it spirit, which I think is incredibly important.
Well, travelling on the road, for me, I started at the bottom and I haven't been working in the music industry for that long. So, you know, I'm 8 months in, and being able to go out on the road has probably been the best thing to start not only the bookings at Lamar Sundays, but also for the artists that I work with in a management capacity. So it's been really amazing to go out and to meet the people from the venues and to meet the people who go and view the shows and meet the people, you know, meet the fans. You talk to them, see what they want. And you also get to build really good relationships with the artists that you play with over at these events.
I definitely see touring as an effective way of networking with other artists and band managers and letting them know that they should come to Adelaide to perform, and that we have inbuilt audiences here with the bands that are playing that can support the music of other musicians and venues that can cater for them as well.
Groups like Four Words and Plus One and Alice Fraser at Lamar Sundays, who are just doing their best to bring as many of the best interstate artists to Adelaide, just for us to experience them and just for them to be included in our music scene. Because the more that Adelaide artists integrate with other scenes from other states of Australia, the more that we get put on that platform.
If you wanted to make bands from interstate feel good about coming over and potentially coming over again and telling their friends about it, you want to kind of go, this is what we can offer and this is how you're going to be treated. You might not make much money, but you have a great time and it's good to get to an Adelaide audience. And look at all these people that are here, they're genuinely interested in your music. Maybe you'll want to come back as a result of that. You won't just feel like you're being ignored, you know? I feel like, and the only reason that I really mentioned this is because I feel like that is really starting to take effect.
I guess one of the best parts about, you know, starting Lamar and doing that along with actively touring on the road is that I've been able to offer these bands an avenue where they can get a guaranteed payment when they come back and do shows here in Adelaide and South Australia, because it's really nice to be able to meet them and then offer them the point of coming back to Adelaide and then giving them the resources, so giving them the names of venues, the names of contacts and the names of bands that would really suit their style. And by doing that with Lamar has been quite astounding, the number of acts who've come to Adelaide, they've done one other show but then played Lamar. And really a prime example of that is Kim Churchill. He started with us back at the very beginning and then he came back twice since then, one of them being the main national support for Michael Franti.
Adelaide's isolation sometimes makes it hard for local artists to reach new audiences in the live arena. So a talented musician in Adelaide might be confined to Adelaide just because they can't afford to travel and they can't afford the accommodation, which is something that makes it harder for musicians from Adelaide. Artists like Vorn Doolette. Vorn Doolette he's a fantastic artist. He's up there with, you know, Australia's best folk artists, and his debut album was magnificent, and even he finds it hard to tour in the conventional way. He's, you know, devised a way for him doing house shows that he will just travel and then be supported by the people that he's playing to. He'll stay with them, he'll be fed by them. It's a clever business model because this allows him to spread his music and do it in a way that he can sustain himself, and he can really give his all to making this venture for him successful. that works perfectly for him. And I guess it goes to show that you don't necessarily have to do things conventionally to do things well.
So the National House Concert Tour came together from a number of different things. I think I'd thought of the idea, and also my manager had thought of the idea a number of times last year. And then we had friends doing it. So it's not exactly an original idea. I mean, it's been around for, I guess, hundreds, if not thousands of years. I mean, it's the original venue, really. Before there was pubs and clubs, people just would have music in their homes. Anyway, so it all kind of came together at Woodford just last year, and we sort of thought, why not? Like, it's the perfect sort of place for our sort of music. So we spammed the hell out of everybody on Facebook, and we got a really big response, which was really surprising. I wasn't expecting it to come back as strong as it did, and people seemed super keen for it. And so far, I've done 19 in about 2 months, and I have to say, like, they're so much better than anything I could have imagined. You get to connect with people on a level that's, yeah, pretty much beyond anything I've ever experienced. During this last couple of months, I have made a profit, for probably a significant profit for the first time in my career. And I find that really amazing. And I think a big part of that is, it's because it's a different model. It's, you know, it's doing it in people's houses where you don't have to pay for a sound guy, you don't have to pay for this PA, and you're not paying for your own accommodation and food. For the audience side, I mean, from what I've experienced, people seem to really, really like it. Like, it's something different. This is a musician who these people who admire and they connect with your music, and they want to connect with you as a person. They want to experience you and your thoughts and feelings. And so for them, I think it's a really interesting, nice experience, because they invite you into their home and they can have you at their table and show you what they do and what kind of music that they like. And that's a really beautiful experience. You get to connect with the people who actually enjoy your music, and we'll sit around a kitchen table and tell you that they've made love to one of your songs, or that they listened to this other song because their grandfather died and your song helped them get through that or something. And I mean, and that's special, man. That's what a big part of it is, what music's about.
Used to spill with four legs, was meant to fall that easy. But you give it an injection and you make it mean. Rain down with spears from the clowns with tears in their eyes. Open the gate for the rock. It rocks you as a child. It rocks you wild and crazy. Crazy as it takes, it grows in the ground. Legs all afraid as it dances. The legs on your rocking horse for rain. Will you take an axe to its wooden head? Riches to cook your bread. Cowboys should ride cows like the name suggests.
Heavenly voices to horsemen before that shed. Watch their sons are saddled dead. Many wives with a king upon their breasts. Open the gate for the rocking wars. It rocked you as a child, it rocks you wild and crazy. Dragons make him in the mall. We got funny men with souls who are poking at their clothes to make them angry and sold, just so the crowd can frown as he's jumping up and down and their prince upon his back. And when he conquers the beast, we'll all have a great feast and celebration.
When we first kind of engaged and approached Auxilla about doing like the last episode that we wanted to do, they came to us with big ideas about, you know, we want to do a finale plugged in this like you know, abandoned venue with lights going everywhere, and you know, it was a bit formulated for our tastes, but it really just, this is their nature. They want to put on the best show that's possible, and they want to use, like, they want the best technicians. They want, you know, they want lights. They want the best sound that they can have. They want people dancing. They want to dance themselves. They want art behind them. They just want to create an experience for people, and I think that's important. They're not just settling for mediocrity. They want to improve. And they want to improve the experience for the audience, and that's important for other Adelaide artists to kind of adopt that mindset as well, to do something, but to do it right and to do it as best as they can.
Well, I do think that it is recognised that bands need to be more thoughtful with their content to make their shows more exciting for fans to come along to. They're not just a standard boring gig and every gig be the same. With Coopers Alive, for example, their showcase series, they'll put, say, three bands together and they'll give that band, well, not the band, they'll give the collection of bands a budget for that gig, and then they can work on developing a theme, a name for their show, and then they'll have, yeah, money to use props or whatever they want on stage. And then it really adds something to each show. And you're like, oh, did you go to that show? They had like giant cactuses and that kind of thing on stage. Like, it's just really cool. Maybe wear a little bit of a costume. You never know. But you are performing. It's a performance. And so to be able to have that, I think it's really cool. And I think that it's that audiences want to be excited. They don't want to be bored when they go to shows. So make it happen for them. They're paying money. Put on a show.
Rather than just play music to people, we try and create like an event.
Yeah. Like it's make it more fun than just five or six guys on stage playing a show.
You want something there that every member of the audience can either relate to or capture, sort of thing. So it's, you know, we've started working quite closely with the lights tech as well, who's come on board really well.
They were very much into having a real enjoyable time for the people. And at the same time, I was coming from, well, when I do shows, they tend to be better because, you know, there's a lighting show that's reinforcing it, and it's through the matching the dynamics and the groove and the mood to the music. And so I was looking for a way to help bands create a bigger show. And so it was really a meeting of the minds kind of thing. And our two aims kind of paralleled and connected. And that was the first way that I got involved with Auxilla. Well, when a punter or someone from the general public goes to see a show, they're not putting on headphones and listening to a band. They're standing there and watching a band or dancing to a band. And so part of that is that it's a visual experience.
Thank you.
When Sam, Kieran and Ariana started making these films, I guess they didn't really have anything to work with other than, I guess, what they knew. They knew a handful of artists. Kieran knew, he'd studied film and he was just looking for some practical experience. And Sam, through music management, knew how to produce these films. But still, to do things properly and to be perfectly equipped for making these films in the time frame that we needed, that process got perfected over a year. And 12 episodes ended up being produced for the Six on the Street documentary, as well as a range of others for other series that got started.
When I think back to when we started the Six on the Street project, we were pretty well working with only one kind of SLR camera and sound gear that we were borrowing from a university. And probably on reflection, we probably weren't ready to start making the films for the first one that we released. But I think the most important thing that I can think is that you just have to start projects here in Adelaide and get them rolling, and you will learn how to get better at creating the art that you do. And it's probably just more important to create these projects to kind of make people continually excited about Adelaide music and that kind of thing. And the more people that start these projects, which is just a moment in time really, it just allows for us to have a really active music scene and just get people more active in general.
We weren't amazing, we didn't really know what we were doing. We were kind of just, seeing how it went. And I think it became apparent that we had something pretty cool going, not only because our audience numbers were growing, which we could tell by the counts on YouTube or Vimeo or whatever, but people really wanted to be involved. And I loved the passion that we could see through all of that. Our team doubled, like, within the first few episodes. We had so many people like, hey, can I come along to a filming? I have a camera. It was really cool. And since then, it's become really apparent that we'll talk more about what we're doing, and you just chat to people who want to be involved in it. There's Stobie Sounds who are doing their thing, distributing music. There's even like ADD Recording Facility, who are recording bands at no cost just because they want to be able to offer that to bands who aren't going to be able to output their music otherwise. That's what we're doing. We're filming bands so that they can have something visual to show everybody and spam everyone with on their Facebook so that they can promote themselves. And I didn't expect anything so big to come out of this. I was like, yeah, this project sounds cool. I don't know how it's going to go, especially 12 episodes. Like, but sure. I think it's cool.
I think the bond that we've developed as a crew is something that is second to none. I think we've had the chance to network with each other, meet other people that were involved in similar type productions. And it's come to develop us as more than just friends, but colleagues and something even maybe further than that. But this is something we'll remember.
Really, Kieran?
I think this doing? Was this is a.
What have you been doing? What's Ariana been doing with you?
Cuddles.
I'm not afraid to die.